God being Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit, yet all one being, doesn't seem to make sense.
The Trinity deception. When I first set my mind and spirit to the task of refuting the Trinity in a video series, my mind resisted, simply because those who cling with tight white knuckles to the Trinity teaching have deceived themselves. They refuse to hear from God's own spirit, preferring instead their own vain religious philosophies. They won't listen to God. Why would they listen to me? Yet I continue to hold out a hope that some may heed the Spirit and be delivered from their own self-delusions. So I decided to dedicate this series of videos to demonstrating how they have deceived themselves, and to offer some insight as to why. Hebrews 1:8, the deliberate misquote.
But if you come over to Hebrews chapter number 1, you'll notice that God the Father is not the only person in the Bible who is called God. In Hebrews chapter 1 in one hand and John chapter number 1. Hebrews 1 and John 1. Hebrews 1 verse number 8. Under the Son, He, and that's the Father, saith, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the throne of Thy kingdom. Notice that God the Father looks at God the Son, and He says, Thy throne, O God.
This is one of the most blatant examples of deception used by those desperate to prove Trinity using Scripture. I call it deception because not only do they take the verse, Hebrews 1:8, out of context, but Hebrews 1:8 itself is a quote from Psalms, and they have the author of Hebrews taking that quote out of context as well. Just for clarity, let's listen again as Richard Jordan describes what Hebrews 1:8 supposedly is saying.
Notice that God the Father looks at God the Son, and He says, Thy throne, O God.
You will find this interpretation of Hebrews 1:8 is unanimous among Trinitarians. Yet, it is easily shown that Hebrews 1:8 is not God the Father speaking to God the Son, saying, Thy throne, O God. Just by reading the original text that the author of Hebrews herein quotes,
Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of Thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows.
Who says thy throne, O God, in Psalms 45:6? Is it the Father speaking here to the Son? Actually, no. It is King David, the author of Psalms, speaking to the God of heaven. Just look at Psalms 45:1.
To the chief musician upon Shishanim, for the sons of Korah, Mahil, a song of loves. My heart is inditing a good matter. I speak of the things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer.
In Psalms 45:6, King David writes, Thy throne, O God. Yet the author of Hebrews begins his quote of those verses with, But unto the Son he saith.
But unto the Son he saith, Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom.
What does the author of Hebrews mean by unto the Son he saith? The Trinitarians read Hebrews 1:8 and then stop and conclude that the half quote, Thy throne, O God, is the context of the statement, unto the Son he saith. But the author of Hebrews does not just quote Psalms 45:6, but also 45:7. Hebrews 1:9, therefore, cannot be left off without deliberate deception. For the context of Hebrews 1:8 and 1:9 is Christ's preeminence over the angels and His status as heir apparent to the throne of God. It is Christ's righteousness which is the scepter of righteousness mentioned in Hebrews 1:8. And it is Christ who is anointed above His fellows, angels, in Hebrews 1:9.
Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows.
by reading unto the Son he saith, and then reading only a partial quote, Thy throne, O God, the Trinitarians deliberately deceive you into thinking the Father is talking to the Son. The part of the quote which is meant for the Son, or unto the Son, is never read, namely Hebrews 1:9, Psalms 45:7, actually, which is the context of Hebrews chapter 1 to begin with.
God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds.
As is clearly seen here, the subject or context of the chapter is Christ's appointment as heir to the throne and his elevation in rank above the angels, a theme that is repeated over and over again in the chapter.
Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the Majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they.
Trinitarians never read these verses prior to or after the Hebrews 1:8, and now we see why. For common sense dictates that if Christ is God from the start, then he does not have to obtain a name that is above the angels. And notice that in Hebrews 1:4 it states that Christ is made or created.
Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Being made so much better than the angels, being made so much better than the angels, being made so much better than the angels.
When we are done studying Hebrews chapter 1, it will leave the honest student puzzled how anyone could come away from the chapter thinking its author preached Trinity. Take, for example, the way the author points out that God felt it necessary to make it clear to the angels that his Son was above them in rank.
For unto which of the angels said he at any time, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, he saith, And let all the angels of God worship him.
Common sense dictates that if Christ is God from the very beginning, why would God have to tell the angels to worship him? Did not the angels know? Is Trinity a mystery to them as well? Yet here is where the Trinitarians will continually fail in their spiritual understanding. Because the Christ is not the only Son discussed in Hebrews chapter 1. We who have been given the power to become the sons of God through his name are included. That is why the author, when speaking of the Christ, says, the first begotten. It is also why he includes chapter 1 with this statement.
Are they not all ministering spirits, sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation?
For the context of Hebrews 1 is about Christ as the heir and his promotion above the angels, but it includes his body, all fellow heirs, which is all of the sons of God, of whom he is the firstborn among many brethren.
For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together.
So what does all of this mean? According to the author of Hebrews, the blessings given to the Son are also given to the heirs or joint heirs with him. If this were not so, then they could not be called joint heirs, nor could they be referred to as fellow heirs with Christ. If Trinitarians are correct in their understanding of these verses, we, being fellow heirs and joint heirs with Christ, therefore, are included. And unto us God has said, Thy throne, O God. Nothing shows that the Trinitarians do not understand what it means to be a son of God more than their handling of Hebrews chapter 1. Their reading it the way they do demonstrates that they don't believe they have equal status as sons of God and brethren of Christ, in clear contradiction to all the teachings of the apostles. In fact, that is the purpose of Trinity, to take away our inheritance in Christ and to rob us of all that God has offered, to make Christ unattainable. Thus, Trinitarians make the status as Son of God and heir to be exclusive to Christ and to be an indication of his divine nature and his membership in a triune Godhead. If that does not rob us of our inheritance as fellow heirs and brethren, sons of God, then I don't know what does. For if Christ's status as Son comes from his being God incarnate, then none of us are truly sons of God, and the apostles were all liars.